Good morning. Actually, it's not morning, it's late afternoon. And you may be watching this at night, or at lunchtime, or in the morning. So I guess I should say good day. My name is Dan Clater, and I want to welcome you to our internet cyber service at FPC Montrose. I have something really hard to talk about this morning. After many months of prayerful consideration and hours of significant and hard deliberation, the session has decided unanimously to terminate the contract of our interim pastor, Reverend Mike Motzko. Mike is a great guy with a great heart, and he's very committed to his faith. That's what made it so hard. Things like this are very hard. They're tough. But the bottom line was that he was not adequately fulfilling his role as interim pastor of our church. To deliberate more in more detail or at length, and that's often what people want. They want to know what happened, is inappropriate since it is a personnel issue. It wouldn't be fair to Mike. Just know that your session is trying its hardest to do what is best for our church. That's our job. And it's not always the easiest of jobs. We are here for you and would welcome to talking to you, answering your questions, those that we can answer. Also know that we have been working hard to put into place pulpit supply, support for our staff, and many other things that I won't bore you with. Speaking of pulpit supply, on a brighter note, I am pleased to announce that the sermon today will be given by Pastor Paul Parsons, previous pastor at FPC Montrose, recorded in Westcliff, Colorado, where he now lives, and I believe he did that this morning. He has offered not only to preach today, but once we are back to normal church, where we can gather, hug, shake hands, and do all those things that we miss, he has offered to come once a month to preach in Montrose and serve as communion. He has told us he is honored and excited to come and help out, and we are pumped to have him. Please pray with me. Father, I pray for our country. I pray for our world. I pray for our state. I pray for our county. I pray for our town. I pray for our church. I pray for our families and our friends. I pray that you keep us safe and keep us focused as we maintain through this pandemic that we are dealing with. I pray that your Holy Spirit will miraculously work its way through the waves of the magical waves of the internet, and that what happens in this service today will positively impact everybody that's watching for your kingdom. And I pray all that in your name. Amen. Now's the time where whoever you're watching this with, I want you to take time to hug them. And this is my hugging prop, my wife Carla. And that's what I miss from church.
Dad.
Oh, and Arthur, oh! I squeezed him too hard. And if you're at home alone, you remember when we're back at church tomorrow, you keep track of how many hugs I owe you. Now please join me in the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to him glorious praise. All the earth worships you, O Lord. They sing praise to you. We sing praises to your name.
Good morning, FPC. Welcome to worship. We hope that you enjoy this time with us, and whether you sing along or you're just listening, we just wanted to let you know that we picked these songs specifically this week because they're just some older ones that we've loved and they're near and dear to our hearts, and really just shows the love that God has for us. God is everything. God is love. God is kind. God is challenging, and during this challenging time of quarantine, I think that we can all say that this time of worship has been super healing and grounding in all aspects of our lives. And so we hope that you join us, and also when at the end of the singing, when we had all the kids with us, we bribed them with marshmallows for them to sing with us. And so Harper at the end says, "I love marshmallows." It's just so cute. So I hope you guys enjoy it. I also wanted to show you guys little Gabriel. He also says good morning. Say good morning, buddy.
Oh God, how more time.
Oh yeah, ready?
Okay.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Say bye to my friends. Say bye. Say love you.
Love you. We read our confession together. Merciful God, you have made us in your image, with a mind to know you, a heart to love you, and a will to serve you. But our knowledge is imperfect, our love inconstant, our obedience incomplete. In this time of uncertainty and isolation, we confess that we fail to grow into your likeness. In your tender love, forgive us and renew us day by day, that we may live the abundant life that you have promised in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Give me five. Done. Thanks for the hug. I'll never forget that.
Good morning. Welcome to Westcliff. Nicole and I welcome you into our living room. And it's a delight to be with you. Probably most of you have forgotten, those of you who have known me, that 31 years ago today, I started preaching at First Presbyterian Church in Montrose. And the following 14 years, it was one of the greatest honors of my life to be one of your pastors. Such pleasure, such a delightful time. I love that church that you're a part of, and I am so honored to be with you today. And here we are again, 31 years later, with an invitation to me to be one of your supply preachers for the indefinite future. And I am so, so honored yet once again. Thank you to the session for this invitation. It means a lot to me, and hopefully it will work out well for you as well. Just a word about my present situation. I'm honorably retired and have been for 4.5 years. I'm a member in good standing of Pueblo Presbytery, and my one assignment that I'm about for the Presbytery is to be a supply preacher for Trinidad Presbyterian Church, which lost its building to hail damage about, I don't know, 3 or 4 years ago, and have moved to the old Presbyterian Church building in Aguilar, 20 miles north of Trinidad. And Nicole and I go down once a month on the third Sunday of each month to preach and lead worship. And I am really loving being part of small churches, and it is just a delight to be here with you this morning. I am a particular lover of preaching the gospel passage for each week, and so why don't we turn now to John chapter 10, verses 1 to 10, and to hear the scripture. Friends, hear the word of God. Jesus said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not heed them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they might have life and have it abundantly." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that you would move from written and spoken word to become, by a mystery, the living word. A word that is alive and active and that produces abundant life. That we might hear from you directly. And that we might receive in those words the means by which we would become a demonstration of your very life to the world. To that end, we pray humbly but thankfully in the beloved name of Jesus. Amen. Some of you may remember that I experienced a dramatic conversion to Christ in 1972, January 26th, at the very end of the Jesus movement in Baltimore, Maryland. I was a junior at Johns Hopkins University, and I was lost and had been for a long time. And somehow, again in a mystery, the miracle happened of crossing over from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. Jesus came and saved me. I didn't know a lot about how to grow as a Christian or what it is I needed to do. Someone in those early months, though, encouraged me to memorize scripture. And so I bought a little packet of memory cards from the Navigators. And I began memorizing passages. And I know it wasn't more than the third or fourth verse in which I came across John 10:10, which I just read to you. You know, the thief comes only to destroy and steal and rob and kill, but I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. And I remember being stopped dead in my tracks, and I thought, that's what I want. I want some of that. I want all of that that I can have in this lifetime. But the question was then, and still is today, but what did Jesus mean? When Jesus says abundant life, what does he mean? Lest we go running off after hopes of the American dream or something filled up with discretionary spending money and just whatever it is that brings me happiness or delight, what did Jesus mean? Because he meant something specific. And not just whatever it is that we wish the abundant life would consist of. And so in order to be able to get at that, we really need to go into the passage and get close to it, immerse ourselves in it. John 10, the first 10 verses, are drawing directly from and a continuation of the Gospel of John, chapter 9. And some of you would be well acquainted with that story, I'm sure. It's about Jesus and his disciples coming up towards the temple complex, probably Solomon's portico, the great porch that had been built around the court of Gentiles on the outside of the temple proper. And there, a lot of beggars and people selling their wares would be gathered. And on this particular day, there's one man, a man who has been blind from birth, and who probably was a regular because the disciples seem to know who he is. Jesus and his disciples are walking past, and his disciples stop him and say, "Master, who sinned that this man was born blind from birth?" Because everybody in first century Palestine pretty much believed that if a person was born with a handicap or a deformity or an anomaly of some sort physically, it was because of sin, that God was punishing either the person or their parents or someone, and was visiting the consequences of that on the person. So they asked him, which one sinned? And Jesus said, neither. This is about the glory of God. And even as he's saying it, he reaches down and he spits on the ground and he makes with his spittle a little bit of clay and then smears it on the blind man's eyes. And then he says, go to the pool of Siloam and wash. So the man does. Maybe someone helps him along, or maybe he's just good enough with a cane or some sort of device. He makes his way to the pool, he washes, and he experiences the miracle. And he can see, and it's the first time he's ever seen in his entire life. So he comes back, and before he reaches wherever it is that Jesus is at that point in that morning, he comes back to the general vicinity, and a crowd gathers, and they're kind of confused, because it was well known from the Old Testament prophets that when the Messiah would come, the clear sign, or one of the clear signs that it's the Messiah, would be that the blind would receive their sight. And so hubbub occurs. Some people are saying, this can't be the same guy. I mean, this is unbelievable. Others are saying, it is the same guy. I mean, look at him. He's exactly the same guy, but he can see. And so they're struggling to know what to do. And they also know that a kind of an executive order has gone out that if anyone says that Jesus is the Messiah, they're to be blackballed and thrown out of the temple courts. So ultimately, they take the man to the Pharisees. And the Pharisees, of course, were not ordained. There wasn't an ordained pastor or priest among them. They were lay people. They were business people, merchants and small business owners and farmers. And they were deeply immersed in the Hebrew Testament, what we call the Old Testament. And they were deeply immersed in the tradition of the elders, the halakha. And they were extremely disciplined in their carrying out of what they believed was faithfulness to God. They're really a remarkable bunch of people. And they were considered by the common ordinary folks to be really the religious experts of the day. They really knew their stuff. So they took the healed man to the Pharisees and told him what had happened, and they said, in much distress, whoever did this, if indeed someone has healed this man, they're evil. They are lawbreakers. It is the Sabbath, and this is an act of work, and so they're a lawbreaker and dangerous. And they begin to question the man and trying to find out whether he's been complicit in this sin or not. And they don't really believe his story. So then they go to his parents and ask them, was he really born blind from birth, or is this just being made up? And they said, this really is our son. He was born blind from birth, and we don't know who did it. And so they come back and they argue with the healed blind man. And in one of the most fascinating interchanges in the New Testament, this man, this blind man, obviously unschooled, challenges them. And he says, in essence, to them, "What's wrong with you? What is it about you that you can't see that the man who did this, whoever he is from God? Only God can do this kind of thing. It's never happened before. What's wrong with you?" And they get furious and they revile him and they excommunicate him. Throw him out. "You are now an outcast. No one can have anything to do with you, or they'll be soiled and have to come to the temple to go through purification. You are nobody. Get lost." A little later, Jesus, in hearing about this, finds his way back to the fellow. They have a dear interchange. The blind man, now healed, worships Christ himself. There are other people around. That's where we enter into chapter 10. And in verse 1 of chapter 10, Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you." It is a technical and an important term in the Gospel of John, which always triggers Jesus interpreting what just happened. What happened in chapter 9 is his focus. He's not just beginning to teach something that's esoteric and that is goes off in its own direction. He's talking in the entire 10 verses of our passage today about what just happened in chapter 9 and the figures that will show up in what he's teaching in 10 are the figures that they have just seen in the story that's unfolding. Excuse me a minute. So Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, let me tell you what just happened." And he begins with a metaphor of the sheepfold. This is very common in the Old Testament, that the people of God were referred to as the sheep inside the sheepfold. But Jesus seems to have particular interest in the common folk, the little people, the Mary and Joseph kind of people, the blind man kind of people. They are the Am Haaretz, the people of the earth in Hebrew, the little folks, ordinary folks, maybe like you and me. And so he is picturing them and the condition that they're in. And he says, unfortunately, there have been some who have crawled in over the sheepfold fence and have gotten into the midst of the sheep that belong to God. And they have appointed themselves as being shepherds, the good shepherds. And Jesus says, but they're not. They did not come in by means of the gatekeeper. And he seems to be implying, but he doesn't say outright, that he is the gatekeeper. But they have come in by other means, and they're pretending, and they're dangerous, and they are robbers, and they kill, and they destroy. And you can't help but be picturing, just like they just have done with this blind man who's been healed. He says, but the sheep won't follow them because they don't know the voice of these robbers, these so-called good shepherds. And you can't help but picture what's just happened. The blind man challenges them, these Pharisees, because they're not just not talking right. He doesn't recognize their voice. They're not right. At this point, what becomes obvious is that, like so often happens, they they don't really understand what Jesus is saying. So he reframes it. And this time he gets specific and he uses one of his great I am statements. He says, I am the gate, or I am the door. And only those that come through me are the good shepherds. If they come in by any other means, they're illicit. And they are dangerous to the people of God. I am the way in for every good shepherd to be found in the church. It's an astonishing claim. He basically is saying, I am the great determiner of the teachers of the Word of God, or of the people who are going to shape and mold the people of God, and only me. Now, there's a warning in this. Just think for a moment about these Pharisees who are immersed in the Word of God. And yet, as Dale Bruner says, they look right at Jesus, this one who is the open door, and they don't see him. They cannot in any kind of way experience his love, his words, or his deeds as being from God. Instead, all they can hear is heresy, blasphemy, and danger. And they know they've got to get rid of him. In our day, we have this same sort of thing go on. On what you might call the theological right wing of the church, we have countless folks who are immersed in Scripture, who love it apparently with all their heart and mind and soul and strength, and are dedicated to an extremely disciplined way of living. And yet when push comes to shove, it seems as if they don't know anything much about the love of God that's in Christ. What they know is condemnation, separation, vilification, just like the Pharisees. And on the other wing of the church, on what we might call the theological left of the church, you have people who are deeply committed to the great contemporary issues of our age that need justice and peace. And yet it's as if they can't see Jesus, that they don't recognize that the only way these things can be addressed is somehow in the power and wonder and love of Christ. He becomes like a symbol, but he is not their lifeblood. Jesus is emphasizing here Christocentricity, that it is essential that those who mold and shape the sheep, the people of God, has to be those who have been chosen and vetted and empowered and given life by Christ himself. The one who enters by the gate, Jesus is saying, the one who is then empowered by him begins to teach, demonstrate, attract, protect, feed, lead, bless, mold the people of God. And so, what happens to the people of God? Well, they enter into abundant life. The abundant life in the Gospel of John is really no mystery. The abundant life, Jesus says in many places in the Gospel of John, is the life that is held, experienced, and is at the very center of God who is Father, God who is Son, and God who is Spirit. It is the life of the Trinity. That when we come to Christ, we are drawn into and become part of the life of the triune God. The means by which this happens is Jesus himself. And he makes no bones about it. He is our abundant life. It is his life that when we begin to experience it, we experience it as abundant. It is amazing. It is the vine and branches, the life of the vine flowing into you and me. This life is the abundant life. It is the life of the age to come, which is promised to all of us who have trusted in Christ. And yet it's already breaking in. We taste of it. It is partial, but it is beloved. And it gives us hope and encouragement about where it is that humanity and life is going. But this fourth thing I want to tell you about the abundant life is maybe the most important of all. It is not dependent on externals. In fact, it is about the life of Christ in all of its situations. In particular, even in the darkest, most deep sufferings of our life, we will find the abundant life. Because it is the life of Christ Jesus in his sufferings that we've entered into, and all that was present in him, for him, all of that abundant life is ours as well. Even in the horrors of the ER and ICU wards of hospitals in New York City in a pandemic. The abundant life of Christ will be discovered. And so, where do we get this? How does this work? Well, let me be bold to say that this passage is all about you and me, but it is really all about you. At First Presbyterian Church in Montrose. Because at least ever since John DeSanto was there, you have been a church of true shepherds. You have been a church through whom abundant life has flowed. You have drawn people into abundant life. It is your hallmark. It is who you are. I think of a Julianne Fraley Gilchrist, who in her 2.5 years with you was given such life and heard the call of God to become an ordained pastor. Or Bo Smith, likewise. I think about Barry and Linda Nearing hearing from God one Sunday morning that the foster children that they had taken into their home, they were to adopt. And they did, and they raised them, and then turned them loose out into life, having given them demonstration and taste of the abundant life. I think about Sunshine Patch, and how many children have been given glimpses of and taste of the abundant life in the preschool. The summer intern program started in 1996, which has touched so many now, hundreds of young adults, and given them entrance into abundant life. I think about Court Players, in which Susan Parsons and Carla Clater and Jeannie Motley and Judy Eicheldinger gave a richness of abundant life for years and years. I could go on and on. But one thing that you need to know from me is that I experienced it firsthand because that's what you did for me. You see, you were the true shepherds leading me into abundant life. And I'll always, always be thankful. So, you already know this stuff. And my guess is that you're not really needing like a refresher course more than just the encouragement. The encouragement after several years of looking for a new pastor, and I'm sure your PNC is weary and still doesn't have the candidate that God has chosen. And you all have had some struggles, apparently, in your life together. And maybe you simply need to know you're on the right track. You're still true shepherds. Do what you've been taught to do. Keep doing it. Go back to the gatekeeper. Go back to Christ Jesus and ask him, Master, could I have more? Would you refill this fountain of life with more abundant life? Because I'm a little tired. Master, give to me that which is the life of Jesus. Go back to the scriptures. Go back to calling people on the phone during this pandemic and encouraging their faith. And when you are permitted to see each other again, face to face, go to people and tell them, you've meant all the world to me. Do what you know how to do. You are one of the most magnificent churches I've ever seen. Be true to it. With that, I think I've spent all that I've got for the day. And now to God who is Father, God who is Son, God who is Holy Spirit, be all glory and honor now and forever.